Hi there, praise in Christ. I just want to have the grace of God to welcome every one of you to the Heart of Jesus and Mary Ministries. And today we are going to share a scripture from Psalm 73, verse 1 to 2. Psalm 73, verse 1 to 2. And the Bible says, truly, God is good to Israel, to such as are pure in heart. But as for me, my feet has almost stumbled. My steps have nearly slipped. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to you, Lord Jesus. My dear friends in Christ, what we have read from Psalm 72, 3 verse 1 to 2 is very critical and important in the life of not just the psalmist, but the life of someone who calls himself a child of God. And because of the critical importance of this very message, of this scripture we have just read, I want to go back to read it again, this time around, much slower. I start. Truly, God is good to Israel, to such as are pure in heart. But as for me, please take note of this, as for me, my feet had almost stumbled. My steps had nearly slipped. Jesus. The psalmist belonged to the nation of the people of God. The psalmist belonged to the nation that God set aside to worship him. The psalmist, the man of prayer, belonged to those class of people, that nation that God said, you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, people that God had set aside to declare the praises of his name. All right? People that God called out of darkness into his wonderful light. And those people are the Israelites, the people of God, the chosen generation, the chosen people. Now, even though that this 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 9 was specifically talking about Israel as a nation, but it is also having its significance in the life of that child of God who has chosen to live the life of Christ. In other words, he has become set aside, a royal priesthood, and a chosen nation, a chosen people, a holy nation, a special person that God has set aside, that through you the glory of God shall be advertised. So 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 9 is not just for the people of Israel, but if it's for you, it is for me. But look at something that is very strange, is that somebody in that nation that God has spoken, that this nation, this is my chosen people, somebody is seeing himself as not chosen. Somebody is seeing himself as no more a royal priesthood, even though he is an Israelite, even though that he bears that identity as an Israelite, yet he was slipping from being a royal priesthood. He was deranging from being a chosen person. He was no more a special possession as he was supposed to be. And the Bible says, I made it clear in Psalm 73 verse 2, that for me, my feet had almost stumbled. My steps had nearly slipped from where? Stumbled from where? From the mark that God has set aside for children, slipping from walking on the path of righteousness, slipping from walking as a chosen child of God, as a royal priesthood, as someone that God has ransomed, delivered from the world of darkness, and brought into his wonderful light. And this person is slipping from light into darkness, from being special to being ordinary, from being a royal priesthood to being like the world, from being like a chosen person into a normal, ordinary person. And praise be to God, this child of God observed that this was the work of the devil. And he said, blessed be the Lord, for I nearly was slipping away from the destiny that God has set aside for me. And this was the prayer of psalmist, in fact, the testimony of the psalmist. And perhaps it is your prayer tonight. Maybe David, the situation of David may be your situation. And maybe your feet is almost slipping. And maybe you are nearly losing your foothold on the word of God. Maybe your prayer life is no more what it used to be. And be sincere to yourself. You see yourself that you are detaching yourself from the community of the saints. If this is your story, if this describes your situation, God is saying today, it is time to come back. It is time to take the word of God and anchor on the word of God. Has your feet almost slipped? Or has it slipped already? Has your foot lost its hold? Have you detached from the fellowship of the brethren? And the Bible says of you and of me today, it is time for us to reconcile with God. It is time for us to embrace the word of God. It is time for us to get ourselves charged in the spirit. And this is what God wants from us tonight. This is what God is about to do tonight. God wants to recharge us. God wants to restore us. God wants to renew us. God wants us to be on fire again. God wants to help us to be strong once more. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus. Father, I pray this night that even at the beginning of the prayer, let your angels come down in a special way and use this message to restore the integrity of your children. Their prayer life, the integrity of their walking with you. Father, I pray that this night you are going to charge your people with fire. You are going to jumpstart your people again. Father, those that their spiritual batteries have become weak or dead, Father, it is time that your children need to come back. It is time to charge their spiritual batteries. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. My dear friends in Christ, this message is titled, Recharging My Spiritual Battery. Recharging My Spiritual Battery. Now, I do not need to introduce to you what battery means, because we live in a world where there are so many batteries, where we deal with batteries. Every time we are charging something or the other, either you are charging your iPod or your cell phone or your electric car or maybe your laptop, there is always something to charge. You can't even use your cell phone the whole day or 2 days without charging it. You find out that you're always charging. What are you charging? You're not charging your phone, actually. You are charging the battery. The battery is what you are charging, actually. That is the active component of that cell phone, of that very car that makes you start, of that very laptop that makes it to function. And without a battery, it becomes a toy. And so this night, God is talking to us that he wants to charge our spiritual batteries. And so the way that we will take time to charge our batteries, I don't really remind us to do that. In fact, we even go and buy the chargers. These days, we even have a kind of a package where you have an extra battery to replace the existing one right away. It's just to make sure you are on the move. And while you are replacing the old one, you are charging the old one. And you always go with your charger when you're going to the office, when you're traveling. Nobody reminds you of these things. But how come we don't do the same thing when it comes to spiritual things? When our spiritual life, our spiritual battery is going down, why is it that we don't remember, we don't have the consciousness we do have when we are going out from the house and take our chargers. Why don't we also be conscious of making sure that we are spiritually charged, that our spiritual batteries are spiritually charged? Why do we not do that? My dear friends in Christ, in Mark chapter 1, verse 35, the Bible says very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. I have a question for you. The Bible tells us in Mark 1, verse 35, that Jesus got up early in the morning to go and do what? To pray. As he was praying, he was charging the battery. And I tell you, the only way you can charge your battery is to pray. It is by prayer. It is by connecting yourself to God. That is how you charge your battery. How do you charge your battery when your battery is getting weak? You plug it to electricity. You plug it to electricity. If that plug is not making a firm connection with electricity, it cannot charge. If there's a partial contact, the battery cannot charge. If your life is not making a partial contact with Jesus, your spiritual life cannot charge. You know what I'm talking about? If you are going to church, but you're going to church to please somebody, that's a partial contact. You see that? You're not making the same contact with Jesus. If your life is just a life of the world, but sometimes you start to behave like a Christian, but you're not. Deep inside you, you know that you are not a true, sincere Christian. It means you're making a partial contact. There was a day I plugged my battery, my cell phone, and the intention was to charge the phone. And after some long hours, I felt it must have been at 100%, only for me to come and look at it and find out that it was not charging at all. It was a partial contact issue. I had to fix it before the phone would start charging as I plugged the electricity. Many of us are that way. We are making partial contacts. And today, God wants to restore us. God wants to bring us back. If Jesus would wake up early in the morning and charge his battery by word of prayer, it means that every child of God got to do the same. It means that every child of God got to be a man of prayer. If you say you're a Christian, you must do what Jesus did. After all, the word Christian means follower of Christ. All right? A disciple of Christ. A disciple means a follower, somebody who is following somebody. That means you are, the person you are following is your model. And so if Jesus is our model, then it means that as he lived his life being a man of prayer, so shall he be, that we also shall be people of prayer. We have to be people of prayer. The Bible tells us that that Jesus, he intercedes for us. He intercedes for us, means he prays for us. Even now, he prays for us. Yes, he's talking to us. He wants us to be his children. He wants us to have connection with him. He wants us to be with him all the time. My friends in Christ, nobody in life will be happy that his cell phone is not charging or is not charged. Nobody. Can you imagine getting to your laptop? You want to do the work for the day. Something very serious for you to do, only find out that your battery is down. You recharge it. Meaning that you can't even do that work. Or maybe you forgot your charger in the house and you find out that your battery of the laptop is going down rapidly. You don't get happy. You get frustrated. And if what you're about to do is something that is very time sensitive, then I tell you, you do everything possible to arrest that situation. I want to tell you tonight, that way we feel when our spiritual battery, when the physical battery, when the laptop battery, when the car battery is down, that is how Jesus feels when our spiritual batteries are down. When he wants to talk to us, but we're busy. When he needs our attention, but we're not giving him attention. When he wants us to start into prayer, but we're not even ready for that. Jesus, keep waiting for us to get up. For us to get into prayer, though we're praying. He feels so heartbroken that many of his children are sleeping, that many of his children are like dead batteries. And so today, God is going to do that thing that you used to do to your car. When you get into your car to go to work, your car cannot start. What do you do? I mean, have you ever had a car that didn't like to start in the morning? Oh my goodness, it's the worst of any experience for somebody who was running late to work, somebody who wants to beat traffic, and you get into your car and your car could not start. Would you be happier? Of course, no. Nobody will be happy. You'll be fidgeting. You start making calls to the office. Look, I have an issue, an emergency. I want to fix it. Jesus wants to fix our connection with him tonight. That's our spiritual batteries that are dead. Jesus is concerned. In fact, this message is coming at a timely time. That Jesus is saying, enough is enough. It is time for my children to have their battery on fire again. And he wants to do in our lives the same thing we do when our car batteries are down and the car could not start in the morning. What do you usually do? Have you ever called a neighbor? Please, could you help me to jump on my car? Could you help me, please? And if you don't have your neighbor, you still want to use, maybe to call the emergency people to come and help you. You want to do something to make sure you get on the road. Can you imagine what life is like when you get up, ready to go, and you're outside, you shut the door, you put on the seatbelt, you want to start, and what you're hearing is, the car is not starting. There are people that their life is that way, that their car is not even, it's about to start, but not starting. It's making a clicking sound. That's a different sign. If the car is making a ticking sound, it means that at least there's power in the there's power in the battery. But if you put the key in the ignition, you want to start, and there's no sound at all, it is a sign the battery is dead. It could also be a sign that there is a poor contact. Some poor contacts will be so severe that the car appears to be dead. You see the point? Because some power is not being connected. You're not connected to the battery. And so God is saying, today, I want to help you. Many of us that were not making firm contact with God, and that's why our spiritual battle is not starting today. That connection we make, not by your merits, but by the angels, by the power of God, who has sent his angels to come and help us to get reconnected with him. So that we fellowship with him. So that we enjoy the presence of the Lord. Praise the Lord. Are you ready for that tonight? And also, let me also tell you, the car may not even start because the battery is weak. Not the battery is dead. Most of the time, the battery may not be dead, but it's weak. And if it's weak, it cannot be able to power the engine. What you do? What you do is to do what? You go and get another battery to jumpstart it. That's when you call your neighbor or somebody who is going to be a good neighbor to you to help to jumpstart the car. There are people that their spiritual batteries are going to be jumpstarted or to be charged tonight because the battery is weak. And though that their spiritual batteries are dead, something is going to happen tonight because the one that gives life is going to bring life back to the spiritual life so that once more you'll be on fire. My dear friends in Christ, it is time to move. Many times, some people look for people to help them to jumpstart. They could not get the battery to jumpstart. The neighbor had gone to office. Nobody's around to help you. And maybe it's time to push your car. Sometimes we push the car. We try to push it so that it forces the engine to start. And then that way, as it gets moving, the battery will be charging. And this is another way God wants to act on somebody tonight. It is time to push somebody. It is time to push you so that you begin to move with Jesus, so that you begin to move with the Holy Ghost, so that what God is about to do in your life, you will key into that move of the Holy Ghost. So when the Holy Spirit wants to push you, he wants to move you, let us not resist him. Let us not resist him. He wants to touch us in a special way. My dear friends in Christ, I want to deal with the situation where the battery is good, but the battery is not starting. The cells of the battery are not dead. That is to say, the battery is good. Sometimes your car will not start. You call a mechanic. you think it's dead, but they tell you, no, 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 the cells are good. So the mechanic or the technician comes to check the strength of the battery by checking the cells. And maybe there are cells in your life that need to be checked tonight. One cell that is dead in a battery could make it not to start at all. One element of your life that the enemy has taken totally possession of can make you to be spiritually dead. And God is saying tonight, I am coming as a technician to restore you. This night is our night of restoration, a night to re-anchor to Jesus. My dear friends in Christ, that battery that is not starting but is good, God says, I am going to make it good again. I am going to make it fully functional again. I am going to make my people full of power so that the car can start moving. As God is charging your battery, I am praying that it is time to move. When the car's battery is charged and the engine starts humming or on, then the car can start moving. I am praying for somebody tonight. It is time to move. In the name of Jesus, may God touch us. May God strengthen us. May God recharge us. In the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. My dear friends in Christ, the psalmist in Psalm 73, verse 2, faced a dilemma in his life, a dilemma in his spiritual life. He faced a dead battery in his life. There was a poor connection in his life. The battery of his life, his spiritual battery, was not making a firm connection. There was a partial contact. You see, a partial contact is simply a sleeping head of a battery. When that contact is not made, when it's sleeping, there's no enough contact. And so you see some sparks there. You see that? Because the power is leaking there. When somebody's spiritual life is leaking, something is wrong. The psalmist discovered that his life was sleeping. His spiritual life was sleeping. That he was stumbling. And when he saw this situation, he alarmed. He cried to God. I said, God, help me. You called me into a nation of prayer. You called me into a people of prayer. You called me into a nation where everyone was set aside. But now the enemy is about to set me aside to destroy me. One of the strategies of the enemy is to distract the child of God, to make him to slip away, to make him to stumble and fall. And God says, even though the righteous may fall, even 7 times, he will rise again. And so this message is a message of hope. It is not a message of condemnation. It is a message of invitation to come back to the Lord. The psalmist discovered that he was stumbling. He discovered he was sleeping, and God came to his help because he called on God. As we do the same thing by calling on God, God is also going to restore us. God is also going to touch us. God is going to visit us and help us at the point of need. It is time to charge our spiritual batteries. My dear friends in Christ, one of the ways, in fact, one of the most important things you can ever identify in your life that is very critical to solve a problem is to discover that you have a problem. If you don't discover you have a problem, then how can the problem be solved? The psalmist discovered that he had a problem. He discovered he had been a man of prayer. He wrote the Psalms. We're all familiar with Psalms. He wrote chapter 1. Psalm chapter 2, Psalm chapter 3, but the moment he came to chapter 73, he discovered that something was wrong in his life, that he was sleeping, he was stumbling, and he called on God to help him. Have you discovered something wrong with your spiritual life? Have you discovered that you are slipping away? You are making more time in the Facebook than you pray? That your prayer life is going down? Is that a situation you are passing through? You used to be strong in prayer, but now you lag behind. You don't even fast again. You don't even have time to read the Bible again. You are becoming more busy. If you discover that this is your situation, do what the psalmist did. He cried to the Lord. Say, Lord, restore me. Help me to come back. Father, help me. I cannot help myself. Help me. I need help. And so the psalmist acknowledged the need to come back. He acknowledged the situation. He identified the situation. He saw the situation. And this is the first step that is very important before your spiritual battery shall be charged. Before your spiritual battery shall be charged, you must be able to identify that you are no more who you used to be, that you are no more prayerful, you are no more doing charity, you are no more loving God the way you used to love Him. Perhaps most times you get up in the night and pray, but you don't do it again. God is calling us back home. God is calling us back to our spiritual altar. Many of us, our altar used to be the altar of prayer, altar of fire. But now smoke is coming up from the altar, no more fire. God wants to restore the fire on your altar. I am praying for somebody tonight. May God open your eyes. May God open my eyes to see where I am lagging behind spiritually and help me to come back. You wear the shoes, you know where it pitches you. And I'm calling the Holy Spirit now to bring enlightenment into our hearts, that we may be able to see where we are dropping, where we are deranging, where we are going down, where we are stumbling, where we are slipping from the hand of God, slipping from fellowship with the brethren. Father, as you are opening our hearts to identify these areas, Father, we want something to be done about it. Help us to be on fire again. Help us, Lord, to come back. Father, forgive us our sins for the ways we have willingly, unwillingly, knowingly, unknowingly, consciously, unconsciously been stumbling or slipping away. You have been talking to me all this while to come back to you, but I've not been listening to you. But Father, even now I'm asking for mercy. Father, have mercy on me. Your son David cried to you when he discovered that he was stumbling. Father, you gave him an opportunity to come back. Father, give me another opportunity. Give me another second time. In the book of Jonah, chapter 1 and chapter 2, you spoke to Jonah the first time. You also spoke to him the second time. And the Bible says, the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time. Who is the Jonah in the prayer line? Who is the Jonah in this ministry? Who is the Jonah in this fellowship? That God is calling the second time. It is time to come back. It is time to come back. It is time to come back. If we do not answer the call of the Lord, what it means that our boat will be rocking. Ah, Jesus, when Jonah was running away from the call of the Lord, when he did not want his battery to be charged by the Lord caused that boat, that ship, to begin to rock. The storm came against it. But it was when Jonah answered the call of the Lord, that was where the storm in his life ceased. Many of us are passing through storm in our lives because we have not answered the call of God. God is calling us. God is telling us, I say to this world for a reason. You are a special person. You are not like the world. You are not like them. You are different. But we are not answering his call. We are busy pursuing things that are not going to last. But God is talking to us today. It is time to come back. Father, help us. Even now that we have acknowledged the need to come back, that we have acknowledged that we are stumbling, Father, by the power of your grace, may you help us again. May you help me again. Papa, help me to stand strong. Holy Spirit, help me to stand strong. Oh, Jesus. Father, the hour has come. The hour has come, oh Lord. The hour has come for your people to stand strong. Help me to stand strong, oh Lord. Where I have fallen, Father, it is time to stand strong. It is time to come back to you. Father, come to my help. Come to my rescue. Help me to stand up again. Oh, Jesus. Father, the hour has come. Come to the need of your people. Your people want to come back. Your people have discovered that they have been on the wrong path. But Father, now they want to come back. We want to come back. Papa, help us, O Lord. Your word says in Proverbs chapter 24, verse 16, For though the righteous fall 7 times, they rise again. But the wicked stumble when calamity strikes. Father, O Lord, even as we have discovered that we have been sleeping, Father, it's time to rise. Help your people to stand strong, Lord. Let your strength be upon your children. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Thank you, Jesus. My dear friends, for our spiritual battery to be charged, the second point is we should be able to allow fellowship with the saints in our lives. We should be able to allow fellowship with the saints. You see, there is great power in corporate prayer. In corporate prayer, not everybody is at the same spiritual level at the beginning of the prayer. But those who are stronger are spiritually pulling those who are much weaker. You see the point? This is what happened in the spirit. When people come together to pray, spiritual transaction is going on. Spiritual metamorphosis keep going on. The weak are getting stronger, and the strong is getting stronger. That's what happens. That's why the Bible advises us to fellowship with one another. And advises us, do not despise fellowshipping with your fellow saints. It is like sharing the load. Actually, as a matter of fact, when you want to start your battery, your car, and you find that the car is not starting because the battery is weak, and you call on somebody to help you to jumpstart. Jumpstart means you bring a healthy battery, a strong battery, and connect it to the weak battery. That is fellowship. That is fellowship right there. You know what I'm talking about? And at that point, you see the power of the weaker battery growing, getting stronger. The voltage that used to be down will start going up. The power of the battery to start the car will start going up. You see that? So this is what happened in the spirit. The same thing happens in the spirit. When we come into the fellowship and we start praying together, then right there, spiritual jumpstarting is taking place. Spiritual charging is taking place. Have you asked yourself why, when you discover that you are weak in prayer and you identify with a very strong prayer network, over time you find that in a couple of weeks you see that you are fire? A lot of people, they call me and tell me testimonies of how God have used this ministry to revive their spiritual life, to revive their life of prayer and their family. A lot of people tell me that even in their offices, they listen to this prayer as workers in the office. Some people cannot even live a moment without joining this prayer line. Can you imagine that? A lot of people send me mails, people that have not met me before in life, people that are not even in this country. And then from different parts of the world, they send me texts, they send me mails, and they're praising God for what God has used this ministry to do in their lives overseas. God is using this ministry to bring amazing revival. I've not forgotten that testimony from Kenya, a man that was completely blind. And through the power of prayer in this ministry, the man got his sight fully restored. I was full of joy when I read that text. What God is doing in the life of people that we don't even see, that God even with us live in prayer. But just because they are recorded and posted on YouTube, somebody downloaded into it because the Holy Spirit brought into it, and your dead battery became on fire. And this is according from UK's few months ago. I said, brother, I was thinking suicide. Life, I didn't find joy in life again. I lost passion to live because problems surrounded me, and it appeared to me, what am I in life doing? And she said that it was this situation that she dabbled into the YouTube and started just randomly searching for prayers to keep her busy. And that was when she got into one of our prayers that were titled, No More Immigration Wahala. Many of you who participate in that prayer will understand the prayer I'm talking about. I'm going to have that prayer to open the doors of immigration for so many people. Many were very tested on the line. Many overseas that could not get testified because of time difference and all that. And so this sister said, it was that prayer that God spoke to her. She got anchored to it. And then saw her by divine providence. She went deeper and got into our website, went into our YouTube channel, and saw over 700 messages that God has given to us in this ministry. And she said that every day she keeps herself busy listening to these messages. And you could see the joy in her. You could see the joy in her. And so what God is talking to us today is sharing the load, jumpstarting you. The enemy attacks a child of God with so many things. The aim is to destroy a child of God. That thing that is coming in your life as a worry, you are worrying over something. Don't despise it. Because the aim of the enemy is not to keep you worried. The aim is to kill you. And so maybe at the elementary stage, you are worrying. Because he has sent the arrow of worry your way. You see that? But you don't know that the ultimate goal is to advance that worry into health crisis, into problems that will end up either suicide or end up in debt somehow. Because this is his goal, his mission. John 10 verse 10 tells us the enemy comes to kill, to destroy, and to take away. And stand against every power of darkness that wants to destroy you because you are in a state of worry now. I'm praying that every spirit of worry begin to come out right now. And through this corporate prayer, may you begin to be jump-started. May you begin to grow now in the name of Jesus. May you grow above worry. May you grow above that crisis. May you walk on that water like Peter in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, I am praying for you now. May the grace of God locate you. May the power of God locate you. That problem in the family that is sinking your life. Oh, Jesus, may God turn the situation around. May God turn the situation around so that you shall walk on victory, on testimony. May you walk in dominion in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You see, I hear people say that a load shared is problem solved. What I understand by that is that if that is a problem and many people come together to share it, you see, one person will not feel the labor or the burden as much as he or she would have felt it if there was no help. Supposing your car broke down and you must push your car to a safer place, it becomes very difficult task for you to push the car alone. But if you have 2, 3, 4 more people coming to help you, you find that you can easily push the car. In fact, the energy you exert on pushing the car becomes less. Problem shared is problem solved. When you come to the house of God in prayer and you fellowship with a fellow brethren, I tell you, through the power of corporate prayer, God makes you to encounter a spiritual grace to grow faster. God will begin to uplift you in the name of Jesus. So we are calling on the mighty God this night. Let him bring his power and jumpstart us. Let him jumpstart our battery, our spiritual batteries. Let him jumpstart us where we are weak, where we are fallen, where we are not functioning the way we are supposed to function. Oh, Jesus, I remember this man, Samson. If somebody was praying for Samson, If something had been had the privilege to share, to have a fellowship with Brethren, that night that Delilah came, what happened to something will not happen to him. He saw us. Many people are in the trap of Delilah because the load is not being shared, because they're not fellowshipping with the firebrand children of God. And so the enemy comes like a flood to carry them away. But I'm praying that God will vindicate him or her this night from the hand of such spirits. Now, through a corporate prayer, may God deliver in the name of Jesus. There was something I said some few minutes ago. And I said that the ultimate aim of the devil is to kill you. So even when you are worrying, he's not concerned about that worry so much as he's concerned about the end. He knows that if he gets you worried, he disconnects you from prayer. Have you thought of many times that maybe you, I like people come and confess that to me. Many times they keep worrying, oh, and they forget it's time for prayer line. Sometimes they say, oh, how many times will I, God will not tell, let me not go to that big. You don't know it's the enemy disconnecting you. You don't know it's a sign you're under attack. It's a sign the enemy is by the door. In fact, he had come in. When you are feeling weak in prayer, it's a sign of danger. It's a time you're supposed to get into prayer. And if you continue to have that lethargy for prayer, call your fellow brothers and sisters, pray for me, let us pray. This is a time to get into prayers. God is talking to us. And so when the enemy is keeping you worried, he wants to attack your health. You want to attack your business, because when you are worried, it affects your health, it affects your productivity. Somebody could even lose job because of worry, because it affects your productivity in the office, it affects your productivity in the house, even in your personal business. It puts your life in danger when you are driving on the road because you cannot concentrate. So worry is dangerous. The enemy knows that, and that's why he wants to bring that worry. You see the point? Some people worry to the point that they don't want to live again. I talked with a young man in Tennessee some time ago, and he told me today that he was so worried in the land of the Philippines that he decided to jump into the river to kill himself. And so as he went to the shore of the river, just that point, God intervened. God intervened. Amen? But if he had learned how to share the burden, how to share the load, how to fellowship with the fellow brethren, many of us will not be suffering what we suffer today. Many times people, God bless them this ministry, and they leave. They leave. They don't even come to prayer again. But when the problem comes, when troubles come, you start see them calling, Broker, oh, Broker, please pray for me. I say, where have you been all this while? I say, oh, brother, oh my goodness, sorry, but I've not been praying for the past 2 years. I hear that all the time. I hear that all the time. You see, but this is not what God wants. God wants us to maintain our prayer intensity. You know, when things are going well and when things are not going well, we have to continue to pray. God cannot be a spare tire that should be remembered only when the car is flat. God is talking to somebody. Jesus. And so, my dear friends in Christ, when the enemy is bringing out worry, he wants to make sure that he puts in the trap of death. Look at a man like Job. You know, when the enemy started attacking Job, the attack on Job started gradually. He lost his servants. He lost the sheep, the camels. He lost his children. You know, he lost the love of his wife. By that time, Job was not sick yet. But he was losing things, okay? And then the enemy now focused on his health and then made him sick. By the day, the sickness was graduating. All over the body of Job was looking like a man with leprosy, to the point that Job could no more live in the house. He was quarantined in the dunghill. This was a very rich man. The Bible described Job in Job chapter 1, verse 1 and 2, as a man who feared God. All right? And God also described him as a wealthy man in the eastern province. What will make a wealthy man to leave his palace and go and live on the city dunghill, where the people in the city are throwing their trash? And that is because where he spends day and night, that must be terrible. That means this: he has become leprous and was quarantined to that place. Because by law, somebody who is having such a disease should not be found among the other people. All right? And while he was there on the dunghill, very sick, his wife came and said, "Job, curse God and die. Curse God and die." You see, the point I'm trying to make you understand here is that the problem of Job started losing things, losing a property, losing his estate. You know, the enemy came with Chaldeans, the enemy came with the Sabians, the enemy came with fire, destroying things in the house. Now, attack his children, destroy everybody, made him childless. And then attacked the wife, took away the love of the wife for him, and came to zero down on his health. By that time, Job must have been worrying. Job may be concerned. God, what have I done? God, why has this happened to me? And Job said to cause the day he was born. Do you understand that? That was a man in distress. That was a man in distress. But the devil didn't give up. He was after the death, the life of Job. He wanted to kill Job. The aim was not just to make him lose his estate and property. No, the aim was to kill him. The Bible says in John 10, verse 10, the enemy comes to kill, to destroy, and to take away. That is the mission statement of the devil. He could have stopped at making him to lose his property. He could have stopped at making him sick. He could have stopped at making him to lose his servants. No. The target was to take his life. But God told Satan, "You know what? You can do whatever you want to do to Job, but don't take his life." Because God knew that the devil will like to implement that attack to the maximum. That is to bring him out of this world. But if somebody was praying for Job, if Job was in a prayer network, if Job was in a prayer line, where people are praying and fighting prayer, I say the devil would have been frustrated. I pray for you now, my friend. Maybe what happened to Job is happening to you now. But through this prayer of spiritual jumpstarting, through this prayer, may God make you on fire. May God restore your fire. May God restore your spiritual power. May God make you a spiritual terrorist. A spiritual terrorist is someone that is so much on fire, the devil cannot touch you. That any attempt to touch you, you will electrocute that person. He said, let me tell you, when you are fully charged with the Holy Ghost and power, you become dangerous for the devil. You see, when a battery is fully charged, you don't bring the two positive and negative together. If you touch it, you hear, "Pah!" If you bring a wire, connect it, it will cut off the wire. You see the wire melting. I don't want you to go and try it because it can even blow the battery. Because a mighty current will flow. And you see the wire hot. Let me tell you, if the wire refuses to melt, watch it, the battery will break down. And if you touch that wire, if it's a small wire, if you touch it, it will burn you. To tell you that, look, you are joking with me. I used to be a dead battery. I used to be a weak battery. But now I am different. Now I'm on fire. Now I'm dangerous. Now I'm volcanic. And I'm praying for somebody now that God will charge you so that you become on fire. So that you become a million fire. In the name of Jesus, may God make you a million fire. Let him make you dangerous. Let him make you acidic. In the name of Jesus. Oh, Father, touch your people. Father, restore the spiritual integrity of your children. In the name of Jesus, let my family be a family on fire, a family of prayer, a family on fire. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. Hello. Any scheme, every scheme of the devil to implement an attack mission against your life, graduating from simple headache to advanced headache, migraine, to worry with the aim to send it to the grave. That mission, I cancel it tonight. I cancel it tonight. I cancel it tonight. In the name of Jesus. Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Let the power of the Holy Ghost unction begin to flow upon you now. As God is connecting his spiritual battery to restore you, to charge you. Heavenly battery is charging somebody now. Jesus, let him charge you with fire. Let him charge you with power. In the name of Jesus. As he charges you, may he charge your ears so that your ears will begin to hear the word of God. So that you begin to hear the voice of Jesus. Yes, my Lord. Some people ask me, brother, is it true that people hear the voice of Jesus? I'll start looking at them. I don't care if somebody asks any kind of question. God is talking to children and he's not hearing. She's not hearing. I am praying for you today. May your spiritual drums open now. As your life is connected to this spiritual Jesus, to the Jesus spiritually. Let the battery of Jesus begin to charge your battery. Let the battery of Jesus begin to charge you now. In the name of Jesus. You see, when you go to where batteries are charged, there are places where they are difficult to charge batteries. You see so many batteries there. Usually there's a bigger battery, a kind of a bigger charger that charges all those batteries. Look at Jesus as that bigger battery, as that big battery that is charging every one of us. In engineering design, every battery charger has a capacity, meaning that it cannot charge effectively beyond certain number of batteries. But for Jesus, look, for Jesus, there is no number of people that will be connected to him and he will say, no, reduce the number. I cannot charge them again. No way. Bring all the people that lived on earth before now and those that are living on earth now. I'm talking about from the time of Adam and Eve, all the people that have lived. Bring them, let all of them get connected to him now. In addition to all the people on earth today, I tell you, Jesus asks you to bring more. He is the infinite battery charger. So when he's charging you, he's charging you that you may have a life of purpose. He's charging you that you shall not stumble, that you shall be strong. He's charging you that you get into your full capacity. You see, when the battery is fully charged, you cannot mess with that battery again. I am praying for you. May God restore you. May God fortify you. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. You see, my dear friends in Christ, many children of God are spiritually dead. But God says it's time for restoration. Now, for your battery to be spiritually charged, it has to be activated. It has to be activated. If a battery is not activated, nothing happens. How do I activate my battery? You have to make sure that the battery is constantly being charged. You see, let me tell you something. When the car starts, that is, when the battery starts the car, after it has been jump started, you find that if you don't drive a long distance and you stop the car and put up the ignition, and after some time you want to start again, the same thing repeats itself. You know why? Because the battery has not been charged. In fact, it's not charged enough. The car is designed to charge your battery as you are moving, as the car is on motion. It has a charging system. Okay? A charging system that charges the battery once the car is in motion or once the engine is on. So that's why if your battery is weak, you don't put it off, you leave the car on, especially when you know you're not going to stay a long time. And so you leave it on to keep charging. Or you allow to drive it a longer distance. In most cases, you may just have to drive around for a long time in order to charge the battery. And when you do that, and put up the car, you can see that you could now start a car. If it does not start, then you mean that the battery is dead and you need to replace the battery. Now, this is what I mean by keeping your battery charged. That is sustaining your battery. One thing is jump-starting your battery, and then, jump-starting your car, and then your car is moving. But if the car is not charging the battery, it means that the battery is not being sustained. The charging is not being sustained. It will keep losing even what it had, the little it had. Nobody wants that kind of thing. And so, God wants us to keep our spiritual battery charged. So even though that the car has jump-started, you have jump-started the battery, but you still have to make sure that the car is charging the battery. That is, that the battery is constantly being charged. It is something that is very important in the life of a child of God to keep yourself spiritually charged. That is to sustain your charging process, sustain your spiritual life. You need to sustain it. You see, one thing is being pregnant is one thing, but it's not everybody who is pregnant ends up in the labor room. Not everybody. You see that? A pregnancy could end up in miscarriage. In that case, it is not a sustained pregnancy. A sustained pregnancy is a pregnancy that matures to labor room and you deliver the child. Okay? When your battery is charging, is sustained, then you can always start your car. You can always be on fire. When someone says that prayer, you don't give excuses. You get into prayers right away. When someone says, oh man, it's time to fast, you say, oh yes, I'm ready. You don't give excuses. It's time for prayer. You give the prayers. You put God as number one in your life. That way, you are constantly on charge. I am praying for you at this moment. May God keep you on charge. May God help you to be spiritually on charge. When you are spiritually being charged, when your charge is being sustained, it means you are praying all the time. That is how to keep your engine running spiritually. It means you are reading the Bible. You are meditating on the Word of God. That's how to keep the battery charging. It means you are fellowshipping with the fellow saints. That's how to keep your battery charging. And I'm praying today that any power of the devil that wants to distract somebody so that we shall be weak in prayer or not having time to meditate on the Word of God, may God destroy that spirit this hour in the name of Jesus. If a battery is not sustained, if the charging is not sustained, the battery dies, becomes dead. And one of the things that kill batteries is when it dies and is not sustained for a long time. If you leave it dead for a long time, if you leave it in low charge for a long time unused, it dies completely. I hope you know that. That is to say, even when you bring jump starting, no way. You see that? It cannot charge. When a child of God is keeping his spiritual life charged, God rejoices. God does not want us to be spiritually dead. And if you are spiritually dead, God wants you to come back. There are many children of God, regrettably, who are just dead, walking corpses. There are churches that are just dead, altars that are dead, completely dead. You come to a church, no light in the spirit. Everywhere darkness. People are like blind guides leading the blind. Once upon a time, a minister was preaching on a funeral service, and he looked at the coffin and looked at the crowd. The congregation, he said, I want you to know that this corpse has been a member of this church for 30 years. Some people understood that, oh, this man has been in the church for 30 years. But that was not his message. He was talking about people who have been in the church 30 years, 15 years, 20 years, but they are dead. And yet they are members of the church. Corpses could as well be members of the church. Do you know your parishioner could be a corpse? But I pray for now for the church at this moment in prayer. that every darkness in the church, let that darkness begin to disappear. Every spirit of the curse, cold Christianity, frozen Christianity, that has attacked the church, let Jesus destroy it. Let the fire of Jesus destroy every spirit that is causing the church to be cold. Father, bring back the fire in the church. Father, charge the battery of the church again. Charge the battery of the minister, of the pastor, of the Reverend Father. Charge the battery of the parishioners, O Lord. Charge the battery of every member of my church, every member of my ministry, every member of House of Jesus and many ministries. Father, charge everyone with your power. Charge our fire. Charge us to become fire. Charge us, O Lord. May we never be corpses, O Lord. May we not be dead batteries, O Lord. Father, make us on fire. May we not be lukewarm again. Make us spiritually alive in the name of Jesus. Make us a community on fire, a worship community on fire in the name of Jesus. Make us people radical for Jesus. Father, we need you. Help us to have a relationship with you. Help us to gauge our relationship with you. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. My dear friends, sometimes when your battery is weak, one of the ways that the technician can even make a quick test is to gauge the acidity level of the acid inside. It is good to gauge your spiritual life also, to gauge how you are in your relationship with Jesus. Because when you have no relation with Jesus, or when the relation is not strong, the enemy can strike you. So we're asking God to help us and make us strong and fortify us in the name of Jesus. We cover this prayer, blood of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. We pray that God will use the prayer to make us on fire in the name of Jesus. We pray for spiritual restoration. We pray that once more we shall be on fire and never go down again. In the name of Jesus, Father, we thank you. Holy Ghost, we thank you. We give you all the glory. We give you all the worship. We give you all the adoration. For we know that you're always with us. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus. We cover this prayer of Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. And amen. And amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I want to quickly bring to our attention that this Saturday is our first Saturday devotion. It starts 12 noon Eastern Time. Please mark your calendar and be there live. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Tomorrow's reading shall be Psalm 73. Psalm 73. That's our reading tomorrow. Prayer point tomorrow is to pray for this ministry. And pray for Hastings and the environs. We are commanding the spirits, the principalities and powers that have invaded our community, that they must not reinforce. We cancel every reinforced mission, every agenda to reinforce, to cause sorrow in that land. We cancel in the name of Jesus. We cancel in the name of Jesus. We cancel in the name of Jesus. You spirits, principalities and powers in the land of Hastings, by the power of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, who brought this ministry into this world, we stand against your oppressions, against the city of Hastings and devil cities. You spirit that is causing flood, we command you to shrink in the name of Jesus. As the first flood on earth, spirit will go down at the word of God. So I command you in the name of Jesus, begin to go down right now in the name of Jesus. Begin to go down in the name of Jesus. It is time for the dove to fly again. Oh, Jesus. And the dove of Noah. Noah sent the dove with the intention to find out whether the flood had receded to safety, to level of 50, so he could come down. And the dove went everywhere, could not see anywhere to perch, and came back. And Noah knew it had not receded. But there was a time that Noah sent that dove, and the dove came back with an olive branch. Olive branch represents peace. Spiritually taking the position of Noah in this prayer. And I'm sending it to that very dove to go and bring peace to the inhabitants of 15 and the neighboring cities. Let there be peace in this city. Let there be peace in this land. Let the olive branch begin to grow. Let the olive branch begin to grow. As that is growing, as the dove is moving, the dove is a symbol of peace. So the dove is holding all the waters of Houston. So pray that everything will begin to go normal in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.